And now I am going to call Professor Durete Nuno Vieira from Portugal for his nice presentation on forensic and medical legal systems in 21st century, how to strengthen them.
Well, good morning. We are a little late on time, but I always begin my presentations with some pictures of my university. Anyway, allow me to begin by greeting the chairmen, by greeting all the other speakers in this session, by greeting all the participants, and especially by thanking the Medical Legal Society of Bangladesh for inviting me, and of course also the ICRC who sponsored my trip and my coming to Bangladesh. This is my university. I always put some pictures because I always want to invite everybody to visit University of Coimbra, which is an old university. It's UNESCO World Heritage. We are celebrating this year 730 years of existence. As you know, it's one of the oldest universities in the world and one of the three universities that is UNESCO World Heritage. It's in Coimbra. It was the former capital of Portugal, but especially it's a very traditional university. And if you go to Coimbra, you will see that professors dress like that. Yellow is the color of professors of medicine. Each faculty has a different color. And students, they dress like you see in the slide. They dress like that, all in black. They look like Harry Potter. They go to classes every day like that. It's not compulsory, but in fact, if you don't know, the first book of Harry Potter was written in Coimbra because the author of Harry Potter, she was married to a Portuguese, she lived in Coimbra, and so he's very inspired in the traditions of Coimbra and not in traditions of the United Kingdom, as people usually think. That's the Hall of Ceremonies of the University of Coimbra, and probably some of you already visited Coimbra, if you have children or grandchildren, because you have visited the library of the University of Coimbra, because this movie, The Beauty and the Beast, was turned in the library of the University of Coimbra, so probably without knowing, some of you have already been in my university. But I was not invited to talk about university. They proposed me to talk about forensic and medical legal systems in the 21st century, how to strengthen these services. As you know, this is always a concern for the major international associations. The two oldest international associations are the International Academy of Legal Medicine and the International Association of Forensic Sciences. And we have always had this concern on how to strengthen, on how to improve forensic systems in the 21st century. What is the best system that we can have whenever we think about reorganizing, restructuring the forensic services inside our country? Of course, the world, as we know, is a mosaic of different realities. When we look to the world, when we look to the different continents, and sometimes even when we look to countries inside the same continent and inside the same region, like, for example, the European Union, what we found is a mosaic of different realities, of different economical realities, of different cultural realities, of different geographical realities, of different social, political, and legal realities. And of course, if we have so many different realities, this means that we will also have different realities in terms of forensic services. We have different concepts about forensics. For example, we say in the Francophone and Latin countries, legal medicine. We don't use the expression forensic medicine, but if you go to the Anglo-Saxon world, we use the expression forensic medicine. That's why, for example, the European Union of Medical Specialists adopt the designation of legal and forensic medicine in order to try to put everybody in agreement. We have different contents in many countries, like for example in the United Kingdom, forensic medicine is almost just forensic pathology. And if you do clinical forensic medicine, it's just in criminal law. If you go, for example, to my country in Portugal, forensic medicine is forensic pathology, is clinical forensic medicine, but it's clinical forensic medicine in every area. In civil law, in criminal law, in work law, in family law, it's also genetics, it's also toxicology. So the contents are really different from country to country. We also have different practices. We have different trainings. We have countries where the residency in forensic medicine has 5 years of training and of residence, like for example in my country. We have countries, even in Europe, where the residence in forensic medicine is just 2 years, and sometimes even less, and sometimes even done just in the university without any practice. So in fact, we have very different realities and we have very different systems. But in the final, we have to answer the same questions. We have to answer whatever the system is. We have to answer the same questions in forensic pathology. We have to answer the same questions in clinical forensic medicine. And so we really need to know how we can improve our systems in this 21st century. Unfortunately, we don't have a crystal ball that can tell us what is the best solution for the future, and I always say that it will be impossible always to have a single forensic system that can be applicable all over the world. We will always have differences. But I always say that whatever the system is, whatever the structure is, whatever the organization of the forensic services is, if that organization can offer me those qualities that you have in the slide, if it can offer me competence, quality, impartiality, independence, objectivity, truthfulness, promptness and prudence, whatever the system is, it can be a very good system. And even if you have inside the same country different structures, a lab of scientific police, university departments, government departments working in the area of forensics, if there is a good cooperation, a good coordination, and a good communication between them, the system can even so be a very good system. So I always say that everyone is free to have his own choices, to have his own preferences, and we must respect this kind of choices and preferences. But everybody is thinking about how to improve. And one of the countries that probably did the best job on thinking on how to strengthen forensic sciences in the 21st century was the United States. Henry already talked about the NAS report. The NAS report was written because of the terrible situation of the serious problems that they were facing in the United States. And the NAS report incorporates a group of recommendations that even if they have been written for the specific situation of the United States, they can be applied all over the world. The NAS report is a document that we should all read, especially the recommendations, and in fact, it was approved in 2009, and in that year, I was president of the European Council of Legal Medicine in 2009, and immediately, we approved some of the recommendations of the NAS report as recommendations that could also be applied to all the European countries, to all the European Union countries in some of their aspects. And we unite these recommendations. For example, recommendation 1 and 2, it points to the need that we should have, whenever we reorganize the structure in our countries, we should have a single chain of command. We should have a structure, call it National Institute of Justice, call it National Institute of Forensic Sciences, call it whatever you want, but we should have a single command, a national structure that will state which are the best practices, which are the methodologies that we should follow, that should introduce the new technologies, that should promote the accreditation, that should promote research, education, that should say what is the terminology that we are using in reporting, in testifying, in model laboratory reports, etc. And in fact, the countries that progress in this sense are today the countries that are in the front in terms of forensic structures. For example, no one doubts that the best institute currently in the world is probably the Netherlands Institute of Forensic Sciences. And what did they do in the Netherlands? They finish with the labs of scientific police, they finish with the university departments, they finish with the different institutes of forensic medicine, and they harmonize and fuse everything in one only national institute of forensic sciences where everybody is working together. The same as Estonia has recently done, and they have created the Estonian National Institute of Forensic Sciences, putting everybody together and finishing with the different structures and having like that a structure that gives the command and that gives what should be done in order for everybody to do the best and do the same. And I don't see any disadvantages. When I look to these kind of systems, when people incorporate in a national institute, I cannot find any disadvantages, and I see lots of advantages if we have this kind of structure that can give the rules and if we put everybody working together. Because today it's impossible to know about all the areas of forensic sciences. Usually we think that we know about everything, but you cannot be a good expert in genetics, in toxicology, in pathology, in clinical forensic medicine, in ballistic, in everything. So we have to work together. And even when we are in the autopsy room, we have to have with us the expert in fingerprints, in ballistics, in genetics, etc., in order to rentabilize and to be able to achieve the best from our expertise. Another thing that we have to do in order to improve forensic systems in the 21st century is, of course, to increase scientific research. We have today all these problems. We are being accused of all these mistakes, as Henry has shown, and especially in the United States, so we have to promote scientific research. Scientific research is the basis for progress. There will be no progress if we don't do research, but it's also fundamental to show that we are credible, that what we are doing is being well done, and that justice can be supported by forensic sciences. So research is something that we must also be involved, and any new structure must also invest in research. Of course, I know that today it's becoming expensive to publish, especially if we want to publish in good journals, because all the journals are now collecting money when they accept papers to be published. But let me tell you, and let me just make some publicize to this journal, that new journals have appeared, like for example this one, sponsored by Taylor and Francis, which is an open access journal and totally for free, and it will be indexed from 2020 because it's going quite well. Other recommendations that can show us how to improve and how to strengthen forensic services in the 21st century are recommendations 7 and 8 that we can group, and that is to improve quality control and quality assurance. We must promote accreditation of forensic services. We must promote individual certification, and it's not acceptable that in the 21st century we still have services working without promoting individual certification and without promoting accreditation. Accreditation and certification, they are something that tells the people, that tells justice, that the services are working in accordance to international standards. They assure quality control, they assure quality assurance, and one of the best ways to do this is also to promote assessments. When I became president of the Portuguese National Institute of Forensic Sciences in 2000 we did the same in Portugal. We fused all the different institutes of legal medicine in one only National Institute of Legal Medicine, and my first mission was to promote a mixed assessment. I invited people from the country, lawyers, people from the Supreme Court, researchers, professors, but I also invited some external persons, for example, the president at the time of the International Association of Forensic Sciences, the president of the International Academy of Legal Medicine, the president of the European Council of Legal Medicine, and I invited them to come to Portugal to stay for 2 weeks, to visit all our services, and in the final, to make a report with recommendations on what I should change in order to face the challenges of the 21st century. And I follow all their recommendations, and I think it was a fantastic idea, and that was fundamental for the Portuguese National Institute to progress. So I really recommend you that besides accreditation and certification, you promote mixed assessments, which are always the best, because sometimes we are so near that we cannot see, because for us it was already the reality and we don't see the mistakes that we are making. Another thing that we have to do to strengthen forensic sciences is to involve forensic services in teaching and training. Even if we are not inside the university, even if people that work in the forensic services do not belong to the university, establish protocols with universities, with educational institutions, develop undergraduate and postgraduate education. Being involved in teaching and training is probably one of the best ways to assure our own learning and our own training. If I have to teach, if I know that people are going to ask me questions, that will make me study, that will make me try to be updated and try to be online with the new developments and the new knowledge. So all forensic departments, if they want to have a level of excellency, they should be involved in teaching and training. And not only teaching and training for undergraduate or postgraduate university students, also promote teaching programs for the general population, for those that need to know the potential and the limitations of the forensic expertises. Another thing that is fundamental to strengthen forensic sciences in the 21st century is to establish partnerships. We should not work alone. It's not necessary for every forensic service to have all the areas. Sometimes we have in the same city, in the same area, an university department, a public department, a private lab that performs some expertises and that can do those kind of expertises. We don't need to do everything in public services. We can establish partnerships and buy to those partners some expertises when we need them, when we have an excessive workload or when we have some areas where we don't have enough casuistics to justify the investment in terms of equipment, in terms of staff. So establish partnerships, this is fundamental. This is networking, and networking is one of the fundamental things for the 21st century, having a good networking at several levels, local, regional, national, and international is absolutely fundamental. Let me stress the fundamental role that the ICRC is doing in this area of networking, when they are creating all these networks in Asia, in Europe, in Africa, in Ibero-America, for example. It was the ICRC that creates the Ibero-America Network of Forensic Medicine and Forensic Science Institutions, a network that now involves 22 countries and that is producing fantastic results. We are discussing common concerns, we are discussing common problems, we are doing common teachings on how to manage, for example, in cases of disaster where we need to help each other, on showing what we can help the others, and we are also discussing the same SOPs, the same procedures, the same ethical codes, instead of each one being inventing the wheel and repeating word like that, we collaborate and we obtain much better results. So the secret to improve forensic sciences in the 21st century and forensic structures is to have structures that can provide all the things that you can see in the slide. Structures that provide forensic expertises, but at the same time, structures that are involved in forensic teaching and training, in promoting scientific forensic research, in assuring forensic quality, and in establishing partnerships. Of course, there are other things that we can do to improve the systems, but this will be a little more difficult in some countries. For example, we can create other things that we put in Portugal in our national institute. For example, we don't go no longer to courts in Portugal, just in very specific cases. We testify from our services. I testify from my office. We use the system of video conference, the new technologies, and instead of losing a whole day to be 20 minutes or 30 minutes in court, when the court wants to hear me, they just call me, I'm in front of my computer, and I testify to court by video conference. It gives so very good results that today it works like that for the whole population. If a citizen lives in the south of Portugal and is a testimony in a judgment that it's taking place in a trial, that it's taking place in the north of Portugal, it just goes to the court near his home and he testifies by video conference to any other court in the country. For example, another thing that we have always had budget constraints. The money was never enough. So we changed the system. And today, since 2000, when I proposed that to the government, we are paid for everything that we do. For example, when the court asked for an autopsy, when the court asked for a clinical examination, for a genetic examination, everything has a price. And when we send the report, we also send the invoice. And the court has to pay. But then, the cost of the forensic expertises, they enter as cost of the process, and in the final, the convicted person or the insurance company that is behind will have to pay for the prices of the expertises. Of course, if there is no one convicted, or if you don't know who is the guilty person, for the victim is always for free. The state will support it in that cases. But with the money that we generate in those cases where people pay, we are able to maintain the institute, and the Portuguese National Institute of Forensic Sciences gives a profit to the Ministry of Justice every year, about 5 to 6 million euros of profit after paying all the expenses. And from the money that we generate, we pay salaries, we buy equipment, we send people to meetings, etc., etc. Because if we don't do things like that, who is paying? Those that are paying are we, are taxpayers. And we think that the money of taxpayers should be for schools, for roads, for hospitals. If someone violates the law, he should pay for the expertises. If I have a drug dealer, if I spend 10,000 euros in toxicological examinations to convict a guy that is traveling in a Rolls Royce with his private jet, why should I, taxpayer, be paying for the forensic expertises of someone who is deliberating violating the law? So there is many things that we can do. For example, another one that I will finish because the time is pressing, is, for example, to accept complaints. We should avoid re-victimization. In many countries, people have to go and present the complaint to the police, then from the police it goes to the court, then from the court it's sent to the institute, being interrogated several times. In Portugal, the person can go directly to the forensic services, it presents the complaint, and the court process is open. We send the complaint to the court, and the person does not need to go to the police, does not need to go to the court. The process is immediately open because the forensic services can act as court and can receive complaints. and the person will do the examination and later decide if she wants to present complaints or not. So there are lots of things that we can do in these days to improve forensic services. We have to also to rentabilize the new technologies, the new potentials that that we have. But my time has run out and we are already very late. So I thank you again for the invitation. It was a pleasure and an honor to be here. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Professor Direto Nuno Vieira from Portugal for his nice presentation on forensic and medical legal systems in 21st century and how to strengthen them.